Now it's time for the third planetary sessions. This session will be hosted by Professor Widodo Setio Pranowo. Can the profile of the professor be seen? Okay, good. He has a background in math and holding a doctoral degree in that field awarded by University of Bremen. His main research topics are hydrodynamics, sea air interactions, tsunami, and numerical modeling. So I'd like to invite Professor Widodo to take over the floor. Professor Widodo, please, the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you very much, Bang Sharif. Hopefully my voice is clearly. So
it's very clear, it's very good.
Don't okay, thank you. Yeah, so ladies and gentlemen, dear invited speakers, dear participants, Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Shalom, Om Swastiastu, Namo Buddhaya. Welcome to this third plenary session of this increased conference. First of all, I would like to express my deepest condolences to Cianjur people who suffering from the earthquake, which happened just yesterday, Monday, November 21st, 2022. So pray and big hope for their recovery as soon as possible. So we have three invited speakers. The first one is Professor Nining Sariningsih. So she's a professor in physical oceanography, research group of oceanography, Faculty of Earth Science and Technology from Bandung Institute of Technology or ITB. So Professor Nining graduated from Kyoto University in Japan in 2000, and she conducting many research topics such as marine disaster, marine energy, marine heat waves, wave analysis and forecasting, and also many application of the oceanography. And the second invited speaker, we have Dr. Erma Yuli Hastin. So Dr. Erma is a principal researcher in Research Center for Climate and Atmosphere, National Research and Innovation Agency. She was graduated from Bandung Institute of Technology in year 2020. She has many research topics. Most of them is the about the phenomena of the atmosphere, such as monsoon, El Nino, La Nina, IOD, MGO, weather and climate hazard. And also she was conducting many things about the numerical weather prediction model. And we have the also the third invited speaker, Dr. Mariko Ogawa. She is the assistant professor in Center for Southeast Asian Studies, Kyoto University, Japan. Dr. Mariko graduated from the Civil Engineering Graduate School of Engineering, Kobe University, Japan in 2016. So Dr. Mariko Ogawa, having research topic about the quantitative precipitation estimation and also evaluation of parametric estimation for the precipitation using radar observation. So now, after the presentation, we will have, we will continue the discussion which allocated for 30 minutes. So now I would like to thank Professor Dr. Nining Sariningsih. Time is yours, 15 minutes please. And I will give reminder 5 minutes before the end. Time is yours, okay. Please.
Thank you, Professor Widodo, for the opportunity. May I share my screen?
Yes,
please?
Yes, please, committee.
Could you see my screen?
Yes, very clear.
Okay, thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for the opportunity that was given to me and my colleagues from research group of oceanography here to present our research work on marine heat waves characteristic in Makassar Strait and adjacent waters and their possible impact on coral reef ecosystem. So, as we know that the phenomenon of global warming due to the increasing anthropogenic activities in recent decades has a broad impact, especially on the Earth climate. And this global warming issue result in rising air temperature and also rising sea surface temperature. And these extreme temperature events in the sea we call as marine heat waves. So marine heat waves is the anomalous occurrence of warmer seawater lasting for 5 consecutive days or more with temperature exceed the 90 percentile. So this is the global map of the marine heat waves occurrence. This is the maximal intensity. We see that the intensity can reach more than 4 degrees Celsius. And we see that here in Indonesian seas, this kind of research is still limited. And this marine heat wave impact on ecosystem, physical system, also socioeconomics. So in the period 1925 until 2016, almost 100,000, based on the data globally, frequency of marine heat waves increased by almost 34%. And also the duration, and also there is an increase in number of marine heat waves days. This is the data. And we see that how is the importance of marine heat waves in the sea? So marine heat waves is will strengthen water column stratification, weakening of mixing process, and upwelling strength, and resulting lower nutrient supply, and will reduction in fisheries resources and aquaculture production. So here in this study, we try to investigate the characteristic marine heat waves in one of the Indonesia fisheries management areas. And for this shortly, I will call IPME. Here we investigate IPME 713 located in the Makassar Strait. So why we interested to study marine characteristic in this area? We want to know how is the characteristic and also why IPME is important, IPME 713, because we know that in this area, there are high potential wealth of fisheries resources, and this acts as the important fishing areas in Indonesia, and also rich in marine and coastal ecosystem, and part of the global conveyor belt, the main route of the Indonesian True Flow or ITF. So here we use this is the data we use almost 40 years, and in this area there are 5 major coral reef areas in this area, like in Balabalagan Island, Sparmonde Island, Tengah Island, Selayar Island, also the Lesser Sunda Island. There are coral reef areas, and this is the characteristic of the marine heat waves in the last 40 years. So on average, there are almost 2.6 events, the marine heat waves per year occur in this area, and the maximum intensity can reach about 1.7 degrees Celsius, and also the duration of the marine heat waves almost in the range of 6 until 12 days per event. So first, because we have 40 years data, we try to know the characteristic per decade. So we divide four decades. So we see that frequency, total days, and also the duration, there is a trend increasing of the occurrence of marine heat waves. But for the maximum intensity, there is a decreasing of the data. The trend is decreased. And in addition to divide per decade, we want to know also the characteristic related to the Pacific decadal oscillation. We know that there is the oscillation almost 30 or 40 years. This is the warm phase, and after that the cold phase. The warm phase, it means that El Niño occur more frequently than La Nina. Otherwise, for the cold phase, La Nina occur more frequent than the El Niño. And when we want to know the characteristic, we found that the trend after we the variance to the cold phase minus the characteristic in the period one positive value, it's mean there's increasing the frequency. This is also the duration. There's increasing the frequency of the marine heat waves occurrence. But for the maximum intensity, this is dominantly negative. It's mean that decrease. And when we try also to calculate the linear trend, so this is the same characteristic for the frequency and duration. There is a predominantly a positive trend, but for maximum intensity, there is a negative trend. And how about the annual characteristic or interannual variability? Here we just to investigate the extreme occurrence. This is the extreme in occur in 1998 and also 2016. The high frequency and also the duration here, the same year and also the total days. But for the maximum intensity, we found another characteristic. For example, in 1998, the maximum intensity is also high. But in 2016, it's not as high as another case. And for another case, it means that a high frequency and long duration, were not always followed by high maximum intensity of marine heat waves. And another case is here in 1983, we found a high maximum intensity, but for the frequency and also duration is not as high as other case here. And so we can found that high maximum intensity can occur although marine heat waves frequency is low and marine heat wave duration is short. So we want to know what is the possible driving force for the occurrence in 1983, 1998, and 2016. First, we want to know about the local forcing. Here, we investigate the mean wind anomaly. So here, for 1983, 1998, and also 2016, when the marine heat is occur more frequent, we found the negative anomaly of wind. So there is a weak winds compared to the normal. So these weak winds will reduce heat loss from the sea to the atmosphere through sensible and latent heat flux, so causing positive heat contents anomaly in the sea. And also these weak winds will cause the low vertical mixing. Heat is stored and accumulated in the surface layer. So maybe this is the local forcing contribute to the what is the occurrence of the marine heat waves, marine heat waves. And how about the remote forcing like ENSO and IOD? We found that in 1998 and 2016, the phase is from a strong El Niño to La Nina, yeah, and also the dipole moment index, negative dipole moment index. Here also the same situation in 2016, but in 1983 there is a from the South El Nino toward the La Nina, but this is the for the dipole moment is a natural condition. So we suggest that a strong El Nino toward La Nina and a negative IOD will what is contribute to high frequency and long duration and total days of marine heat waves in 1998 and 2016. And here, but for 1983, strong El Nino toward La Nina and natural IOD, they did not necessarily lead to the high frequency and long duration of marine heat waves. And what is the, we want here to know, what is the cause high maximum intensity of marine heat waves in 1983 in addition to weak winds? Here, we try to find out the from the net surface heat flux, we compare at in 1983 and 2016, we see that net surface heat flux is highest. So this possible the cause why the maximum intensity in 1983 is highest. Compare 2016, this is the lowest net surface heat flux. So as I mentioned before, in this area, there are coral reef areas in this area. Area A, B, C, D, and E. And according to the what is reference, this is if the SST exceed 1 degree Celsius, it can cause bleaching, coral bleaching. And if the SST exceed the bleaching threshold for then more than 20 days, and also the total days of marine heat is over 60 days per year, it can cause also the coral damage. So here in this area, in this five area, we found that for a certain year, so for example here, the marine heat with mean intensity were all exceed 1 degree Celsius, and mean duration more than 10 days, and also but the total days for a year, per year, it can more than 60 days. And we found also the report from some references in 2010 and 2016, the what is the coral bleaching has been occurred in several area of a coral system in this Makassar Strait. So the conclusion is in the last 40 years, in Indonesia fishery management area 713, frequency and marine heat waves per decade increased by more than 100%, and also mean duration of the marine heat waves per decade also increased, but for maximum intensity per decade is decreased. So how about the interannual variability? So high frequency, long duration, and total days of marine heat waves in 1998, and also for example in 2016, are supposed to be attributed to the strong El Nino toward La Nina and negative IOD, and there is a weak winds as the local forcing. And in 1983, high net surface heat flux seems to contribute more to high maximum intensity. Otherwise, in 2016, low net surface heat flux seem to contribute more to low maximum in, intensity than compared to remote forcing and weak winds. And the suggestion is to prevent coral bleaching. Precaution need to be taken in the coral reef areas of Indonesian fisheries management area 713, because the marine heat waves mean intensity could exceed 1 degree Celsius, and the duration about 10 days long, at all almost at all area, And in certain years, the total days of the merited which for year can exceed that 60 days. Maybe this is my presentation. Very much, Prof. Widodo.
Okay, thank you for the presentation, Prof. Nining. So yeah, 70 minutes left, so it's very exact time. Yeah, so I was very enjoying the presentation. So from your presentation, I could learn that if marine heat wave increasing for the next coming year, probably we will losing wider coral reef and losing nursery ground for fish. So this might be will more impact on the fishermen and coastal livelihood. So yeah, it's very sad. Thank you, Prof. Nining. So I would like to present Dr. Erma Yuli Hastin. Time is yours. 15 minutes, please.
Sorry for trouble in my device. Thank you very much. I would like to share my presentation first. Can you hear my voice clearly?
Yes, loud and clear, please.
Okay, and also you can see my PPT. Yes, is the slideshow mode now?
Yes, very clear.
Yeah, thank you very much, Prof. Dodo, and ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. I'm Erma Yuli Hastin, researcher from Research Center for Climate and Atmosphere in BREEAN. And in this time, I would like to share our research in our group research, and I acknowledge first to my colleague in BREEAN to contribute these papers. It's about extreme event over in the Indonesian maritime continent. And the two cases of the extreme event I will share is about the Seroja tropical cyclone and the flood inundation, which may relate to Prof. Nining that shared before about the marine heat wave also. So this is the first of our perspective of about the Indonesian maritime continent in our atmosphere inside that Professor Yamanaka also explained it very detailed in the session before. And as you know, I not repeat again, but in our mind, we keep in mind that Indonesia, so-called the Indonesian maritime continent, because has the longest coastline, and the longest coastline it's also have impact to the largest rainfall compared to the tropical region in the world. So such kind of the phenomena, it's about the land and seas. Also, the Indonesia is so-called the world of the miniature of the climate world because the land and seas in composition is actual with Earth. The ratio is about the 3 and 7, and this is similar between the sea and the land. This is similar to the Earth, our Earth, between water and air components. So the first about the catastrophic tropical cyclone. So I mentioned and I will share about the extreme event related to the Earth interaction actually. And we also know if we search in Wikipedia, so keep in mind that we have the tropical cyclone which very catastrophically impacted. And it's the level is 3 in tropical cyclone. And we know that it's killed more than 180 people, injured 47 people, and evacuated 1,000 people, and also destruct the infrastructure very huge. So, and this is the last decade, the last, 5 years, I think, because it just occurred in 2021, in 3 April. So is there any question for our mind that, is that the biggest tropical cyclone occur over the mainland or in Indonesia? As recorded in Flores, the catastrophic tropical cyclone also recorded in Kompas. This is a journalist from Kompas Media shared to me this documentation of this Kompas that at that time in at about 1970, the catastrophic cyclone also occurred over Flores in the same place with the Seroja tropical cyclone. So at that time, the public not mentioned it about the tropical cyclone, and we have no the past data for make sure that this is the tropical cyclone, because yeah, the record of the satellite also very difficult to get the data. So we just know that the very catastrophic storm ever recorded in 1973 and very impactful, and trillion of rupiah is many losses of everything at that time in Indonesia. And this is just to remind us about the tropical cyclone of Seroja. And this is just a remind that at that time, recorded or our data analysis see that so many phenomena occur, and it is maybe a plausible mechanism to trigger the tropical cyclone over the Flores, which is divided into several factors. The first one is about the warming of the SST, and the second one, if the MGO and equatorial Rossby waves interaction, and probably also triggered by the double vortices over the region. So it's just statistically, the tropical cyclone over the southern Indonesia, that probably we understand that tropical cyclone is never occur over the mainland in the Indonesia, we know that. But the TC genesis, we see here that several cases, the TC genesis occur over the internal sea of the Indonesian, particularly in the Arafura Sea and close to Banda Sea also. And we see here that although it's very rarely, but the event of the TC genesis occur originally from the Indonesian Sea. And this is just want to understand the track of the tropical cyclone over Indonesia in southern sea of Indonesia, and also confirm that the originally of the TC genesis sometimes in several cases occur over the internal sea of the Indonesian related to this sea of Arafura Sea and close to the Banda Sea. And this is we monitor and or detected in our system. We call it SADEWA. Here, the phenomena is occur in about 28 May. We predicted here that the double vortices occur over the sea. So, and this is confirmed about from the satellite observation from CCAP, that the double for thesis is a core of this region. So this is the initiate for the Seroja subtropical cyclone, because for the southern we have two double vortices, and the northern vortices for this far track too far from the Indonesia, and the southern maintain to be TC genesis and to be a tropical cyclone of Seroja. Yes, this is I want to share about our research, what we found about the evolution of the double vortices, which may relate to the equatorial Rossby wave that interact with the MGO. So the westerly and easterly maintain so very very consistent and persistent in several days from 10 days before until 0 days in for April. So we see clear here the southern vortex is maintained and become large and become the TC genesis here and become the Seroja of TC. And what we recorded also in the sea surface temperature is about the marine heat wave occur from the 16 until 88 May. So this is from 90 percentile from at about the mean is about two months currently in the period. So you can see that the phenomena of marine heat wave occur in pace with the double vortices occur over there. And this is just a visualization about the MGO and the from the eastward and westward and eastward here that reflect or represent to MGO and
5 minutes left, please.
Oh, okay. It's still first phenomena of extreme event. Thank you for reminding us. It's just for the we want to understand for the pressure level how the two of the vortices interact each other. Is they interact or this two system is independently? So we want to try the analysis. And we also conduct the experiment about the role of the marine heat wave on double vortices strength in the numerical studies. And we see here, GTL means that the default is no marine heat wave. And the STE scenario is if the marine heat wave occur. So you can see here, if the marine heat wave occur, so the strong of the southern vortices occur in 28 May. So you can see here, it's very clearly differences between the scenario the scenario and default CTL numerical study. So it's clear that the marine heat wave have a role to make a strengthen of the double vortices occur over the Indonesian Sea. So I think because just 5 minutes, and I think it's not enough for me to continue to the second extreme event. So just I want to move to the conclusion, I think. Yeah, I think our conclusion is we have so many extreme events, but the catastrophic of extreme event and represent the RC interaction is just very frequent, I think, in recent decades. And we know that so many interaction of the phenomena, multi-interaction is possible occur. And simplification it may trigger in the warming of the SST. Particularly if marine heat wave more frequent occur in the Indonesia Sea. So we just get the last point that our climate has been changing. So we need to develop our full tools to predict the extreme event. And also we have to seriously develop the early warning system as well for better mitigation and adaptation. Thank you very much. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Kindly thank you for Dr. Irma Yulihastin for your enjoyable presentation. So seems during last 20 years, the extreme weather and cyclone more frequent striking our coastal region. Yeah. So if you already showing that this is really strong related with the increasing of the marine heat waves, which is also related with the presentation from Professor Nining. So yeah, so we should prepare something for mitigation and adaptations. Yeah, we should think together. Thank you, Dr. Irma. So yeah, I would like to present Dr. Mariko Ogawa from the Center for Southeast Asian Studies. She will present about the utilization of hydrometeorological disaster prevention information for tropical peatlands based on X-band polarimetric radar. Time is yours, 15 minutes, please.
Thank you very much for introducing me, Prof. Widodo. I'm sorry, could I share my screen from me?
Okay.
I'm sorry.
So, please.
Can you see this right?
Yes, very clear.
My title is Utilization of Hydrometeorological Disaster Prevention Information for Tropical Peatlands Based on X-band Polarimetric Radar. So firstly, thank you very much for giving me such kind of opportunity, committee member, Pak Srema, Pak Wendy. Anyway, this figure shows the Furuno X-band radar that we installed in February 2012 in East Sumatra under collaboration with GREEN. So today we would like to show you about the result using the radar and ground observation data. So as you know, in the island region of Southeast Asia, flood risk and forest fire risk are more strongly linked because the island of Southeast Asia are affected by the land and sea breeze, and it rains a lot. So, and peatlands are widespread in the lowlands of Southeast Asia. So this figure shows the peatland map created by the Indonesian Agriculture Resources, Indonesian government. And then from this map, we could understand where the carbon is stored underground in the peatlands. So the understanding water balance in this area is important when considering fire risk. So by the way, I explain later more, but left figure shows the rain area. Average hourly rainfall at local time of 1 a.m. after midnight during this period. So from this figure, we could understand where the rainfall often occurred in the peatland area. So that kind of information is important as the hydrological information as the first step to know the groundwater level, soil moisture, etc. As you know, in Indonesia, as a plantation development since 1970, the peatlands are dry out by the creation of waterways for transportation. And peat soil like this, peat soil is compacted by repeated wetting and drying, and the physical properties of soil change. So it is important to constantly grasp the fluctuation characteristics of the soil moisture and groundwater when considering the risk of the fire and the generation of plants. So this figure shows a subsidence in the surrounding around the coconut tree. This area, according to the interview with the local residential people, this is the burned area. So such kind of plants are dangerous for spread of the fire because the many kinds of the many roots and stems are included in the soil, and there are many it is easy to the fire is easy to go into the ground underground. So this is the image of the relationship between precipitation and groundwater level. So this is the during the 1997 during haze, there was no rainfall for some months. This bar data means the precipitation per day. There's no rain data during some months. At the time, the groundwater level dropped it by about 50 centimeters. So that's why understanding the relationship between rain and groundwater in peatlands, to grasp water balance of peatland by using rainfall data. But it is not so easy. It is not so easy target because the peatland soil is not so different. Physically, it's different, depend on the other type of the soil So by the way, that we have to understand, I have to understand the rain mechanism and rain areas in our targeted area here. So this is this data shows the satellite data annual mean difference between morning rain and evening rain over the area observed by satellite rim monitor 2004. So from this figure, for example, we can understand the two types of the rain event. More rainfall in the evening than in the morning occurred over the land region of the relatively large island here, red parts. But on the other hand, over the coastal sea region surrounding the islands, the blue area, the more rainfall in the morning than in the evening often occurred. However, our targeted area is East Sumatra, white color, it means there's not so much difference in the annual mean difference of rainfall between evening and morning. So we have to take care more detail by using the rain gauge data and more detailed another data. So this is the example of the lunar cycle of rainfall result in the East Sumatra. Yeah, actually, there is the result of that. Left figure shows the y-axis is a local time, x-axis the latitude over the Sumatra Island. So from the satellite data around sunset here, maximum rainfall crosses central Sumatra from here to here, and then the maximum rainfall leads to the east Sumatra around after the midnight. Yes, we could understand the regional characteristics of the rainfall in east Sumatra also. So, and then we, from this result using the rain gauge data, we could understand the diurnal cycle of rainfall after the midnight around 1 a.m. There's the maximum precipitation were observed in the village of the East Sumatra. So our project study target is that the where and when does it rain frequently at small spatial scale to understand the risk of fire in the eastern coast of Sumatra. This is only still one language data, but for the considering the risk of fire in each area, we would like to know the more small spatial scale of rainfall. And that is what are the regional characteristics of the diurnal cycle of rainfall under movement rain areas. So in order to do that, we would like to utilize the compact type of the X-band MP radar with high spatial temporal resolution. Yes, this is the pictures that we installed the Furuno radar in the Bunkalis Island, east of Sumatra. This is the Furuno radar. This is control room. So Saba is in the green Sripon. And then for this observation, previously we used the laptop. So it is very difficult to observe the rain continuously. And then during the corona pandemic, also, it is difficult to observe continuously because of the long time power outage, but I'm not sure, so I'm checking the data. So however, after the April this year until now, the almost continuous observation could be done. So that's why I am analyzing, I could analyzing statistically method. So this is the result for evaluation of rainfall estimated by Furuno. This data is the x-axis means the accumulated rainfall from a rain gauge data. Rain gauge data are gained from the five station data set, three station data from Belge data, Indonesian government, and two station data was provided by Yamaguchi University Professor Yamaguchi.
Excuse me, 5 minutes left.
Thank you very much. Hi. So from this, from the result of the evaluation, so we could found the heavy rainfall of 30 millimeter per hour or more are often observed in the some of the station 6 and 7 like this, and then for this station. the correlation coefficient is very low. So that's why I think that that kind of heavy rain missed the data, missed the analyzing the analyzing use. Data analyzing missed the that kind of heavy rain. So I think we need to use small time scale of the radar data. So other from the other result, the coefficient of determination varies from 0.4 to 0.9. Yeah. So after the evaluation, this result shows the regional characteristics of the lunar cycle of rainfall. From this figure, we could understand the movement of the cloud and the rain areas. This kind of information is depending the daytime and nighttime. So that's why we could understand the land sea breeze circulation time is dominant in Bucharest Island area. Yeah. So this is the I am currently analyzing, but I will show some of the result. Nowadays, we could found the rain areas by using the daily rainfall. From this figure, the large amount of rain of more than 50 millimeter per day occurs along the coastline, including borders between islands like this, and like this, and like this. So this kind of data is long-term accumulated data one day. So this is important for the hydrological data. So that's why I am currently analyzing by using this data, rainfall data, and the groundwater level data. This is an evaluation by using the daily rainfall between rain gauge and Furuno. This is the future work. This is currently using the ground-based data, rain gauge data, but we could understand the relationship between groundwater level and rainfall. If we could understand the relationship, when we use the radar data, it is expected that we can observe the groundwater level in the widely area. But this kind of result is only can be used only for the heavy rainfall, relatively heavy rainfall. So that's why relatively drying days and no precipitation day, we have to consider decreasing in groundwater level due to the release of water vapor from plants and evaporation from the ground. So yeah, that's why this is the future work. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you so much for your enlightening presentation, Dr. Mariko Ogawa. So this is very interesting. So we could learn that when there is a damage in the forest, especially in the peatland, then seems carbon will be released into the atmosphere, and also some carbon also will washed away by rain, and then carried into the ocean, then causing the ocean acidification. So so this is very interesting, because if the ocean acidification probably will inhibit the growth of the coral reef. So it turns out that coral reefs are very vulnerable to the marine heat waves based on the presentation of Professor Nining, and also the ocean acidification based on Dr. Mariko Ogawa presentation. So thank you so much for Dr. Mariko Ogawa. So now we have 30 minutes for session for discussion. So I would like to invite all participants to submit the question through the slide, to the Slido, which is the link already provided by the committee in the chat room. So we have already question for Professor Nining. So during La Nina, more frequent marine heat waves occur over Central Indonesian Sea. Can you explain the physical mechanism? And the second question, between the local and remote forcing, what is the more important driving force for the marine heat waves in Indonesia? Please, Professor Nining, time is yours.
Okay, thank you for the question. So what is the physical mechanism? So this is the physical mechanism. There are two physical mechanisms. It can be from the ocean, and also it can be from the atmosphere. So for the La Nina, so if there is a advection, so the warm phase close to the Indonesian area, so if there is a advection due to the circulation, so it can generate the marine heat waves. But it's also from the atmosphere. For example, the weak winds. Yeah. So there is a weak wind. So the heat content will be increased due to the weak winds, and also. About the comparison between the local and remote forcing, so for example, in our case here, so in 1998 and 2016, so it seems that remote forcing more dominant, but in 1998 it seems that the local forcing is more dominant. We see that net surface heat flux during the 2000 in 1983 is what is highest. So if we want to know more detail, so maybe it's need further what is further research to more detail, which one is the more important. So in for temporary, so it depends in what year the event. This is maybe my question, my answer. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Prof. Nining. So hopefully we can much learn something from these marine heat waves. Okay, so any other question from the participant? So I think we have a question from an anonymous. Yeah, so the question is going to Bu Erma. So Bu Erma, how about the trend or projection of the tropical cyclone occurrence, especially around the maritime continent region? Probably this is for the next 10 or 20 years coming. Please, Dr. Erma.
Yeah, I think the trend or projection already, not a projection, because the projection is about the future estimation from the model projection, but for the trend and seasonally and yearly already done by Pak Suaidi, our college in our research group. I don't know, is there Pak Suaidi here? But yeah, so I cannot answer because it's related to the research of Suaidi that I've already done about the trend, but not for the projection, I think. Maybe Pak Suaidi will answer this question.
Okay, so I would like to invite Pak Suaidi, probably could help us to answer this question. Pak Suaidi, do you copy? Okay, seems no respond from Pak Suaidi. Okay, Pak Suaidi, so I think we could continue with the question from Professor Yamanaka. Dear Bu Dr. Irma, thanks for interesting work. Cyclone is a vortex which cannot be generated just at the equator where the Coriolis force is zero. However, a vortex generated apart from equator, such as Borneo vortex between Sarawak and Mindanao, otherwise generated between Indonesia and Australia, may move to equatorial region and might be redeveloped due to any warm, wet condition. So you find such a condition for redevelopment of cyclones generated apart from equator. Please, for your response, Dr. Irma.
Thank you very much for your statement and also your insight from Professor Yamanaka. I also approve and correspond your opinion about this kind of the phenomena. The Chang already done his study about the typhoon. I forget the name of the typhoon, but it's occur is very lesser in the lesser of the equator over Singapore. And in the abstract, he mentioned about that this phenomena occur in 100 until 400 years once in, it's very, I think it's very rarely, but the mechanism of the physical of the mechanism that plausible can be triggered for the typhoon. He explained the culture and interact with the Borneo vortex over the Kalimantan and so China Sea is maybe is if the system persistent maintain over the some location in close to the equatorial, so it will be developed to tropical cyclogenesis, like the typhoon occurred in Singapore in 2001 or 2002, I forget it, but this published in the GRL. I think it's very rarely phenomena, but in the warming SST, I think, over the local sea, I think in Indonesia, it's possible. It's possible to be the regenerate and not, of course, triggered by the one factor only or alone. So it will be interact with other, maybe interaction for tropical wave, because the tropical wave is trapped, typically is trapped it along the side of the equatorial. So it will, I think, can produce the circulation. I think the Borneo vortex are also maybe developed for from the activity of the tropical tropical equatorial wave over the Indonesian Sea. Kelvin, Rossby, and MRG waves in the equator. So it's very important for us to always monitor the activity, transition variation, and others, phenomena over the Indonesian region. Thank you, Pak Yamanaka.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Yamanaka, for your feedback. So it is very enlightening us. Okay, so we still have 20 minutes for discussion. Any question? Oh yeah, so we have a question for Dr. Mariko. There is a large portion of radar shadows in the north of radar coverage and is not included in the study. Is it blocked by something such as trees, etc.?
Yes, thank you for the question. I'm sorry, I forgot to explain about it. Yes, there is a shadow area of radar data in the north part, because there is a roof of the building where we install radar. So very the roof the distance roof and radar is very near. That's why we don't observe, we don't penetrate the beam itself. That's why there are many large area of the shadow area. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, so we still have time. So anyone who have a question to or our invited speaker, please typing to the Slido or just raise hand so the committee will give the time for you. Any questions? Okay, probably I have a question actually. So for Professor Nining. So Prof Nining, so do you think that for 10 or 20 years coming, the trend of the marine heat waves will be increasing or more frequent, or what you're forecasting?
I think for the what is the events, I think it's will be more frequent if the what is the global warming, we can what is manage the global warming. I think this is my opinion. Yeah.
Okay, so for Dr. Irma, so do you think that we can improve our system, for example, I don't know, Sandewa or Semar, to handle this global warming? What do you think?
Yeah, it's very difficult to answer. But I think the improve of the forecast prediction system is a must. Because this tools is probably very powerful to help to help people and also to help government to make the best effort for adaptation and also mitigation, and to improving of course is a very huge of the work and also a need collaboration in the very broad sectors. I mean, from any kind of the expert in related to the system prediction, as I think have to join to make a system prediction. And I think the answer, maybe the simplification for improving is maybe the couple of the model between ocean and atmosphere, it's the best, I think, choose for solute to the make a better solution for the warming SST, because the weather pattern in Indonesia already state from the previous studies is very typically is also influenced by the diurnal, not just daily SST, but sub daily SST. It's very I think it's interesting found by Lee et al. So it can answer the improving of the predictions can answer if we understanding the two component and the two component it's considering the prediction system. I think it's just my answer. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Irma. So I would like to have one question for Dr. Mariko. So what your suggestion for us in order to what we should do in order to slowing down the global warming? What do you think, Dr. Mariko? you still okay.
Thank you very much. Especially for in terms of the peatland area topic, we would like to. It is important to understand the seasonal characteristics of the rainfall in the peatland area. It is important for understand the characteristic of the global warming relating to the rainfall. And then if we could understand it, we may be able to forecast the rainfall event relating to the season. And then we could beforehand we could residential people could take care at this for example this season and this year maybe there's pure rain, that's why we have to take care of the giving the fire and that's why it is very important to the basic information of the rainfall, and then from that we may be able to the information leads to the understanding the global warming, and then the for the analysis I think it is important to understand the wind direction also. This is important for understanding the seasonal characteristics of the rainfall. So yes, yes, that's why continuity we have to analyze. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Mariko. So before I closing this plenary session, so I would like to asking all each of you conclusion remark or suggestion for everybody. So I would like to asking from Professor Nining, please. Still mute? Okay. Yeah, okay.
Okay, thank you. As we know from the what is the research result, there is a trend of the what is the occurrence of the marine heat waves. So it can affect the ecosystem. Yeah. So we must be careful. So we must do something together to reduce this the marine heat waves event. I think like this.
Thank you, Prof. Nini. Bu Irma, please.
Yeah, according to our research, we found that also monitored that the occurrence of the vortex in recent 3 years is very intensified during all season in Indonesia. So we have to take more care and aware about this phenomena. And also we see that the intra-seasonal variation and tropical disturbances relate to the couple convective equatorial wave also very intensified, and it have a prominent mode to make or modify the season. So we get weather in dry season almost in 3 years, and it's probably we have to get collaborate in a broad aspect and in risk for researchers and lecturers in Indonesia to take a real action to giving the science for the policy in Indonesian government to help changing this kind of condition. Thank you.
Thank you, Bu Irma. Please, Dr. Mariko Okawa, your closing remark.
We need to point it out. Yeah. For my presentation, we pointed, I outlined the installation of the weather radar in the peatland for the as a disaster prevention information, and then in order to utilize the data, we as the first result, we evaluate the data comparing with the rain gauge, and we could find the some of the data with not so heavy rainfall, the correlation relationship is good, but for the heavy rainfall, the we have to need analyzing data every more small time scale. And then the second result, we could understand the regional characteristic of the dunar cycle and in the Bungaris area. So, and then the third, we currently we are getting the small part of the result, but the result is the more calculating the more long-term scale of the rainfall, and then the we are analyzing relationship between the groundwater and rainfall. In the future work, we want to utilize the data and apply the data into the model of the estimating groundwater level. Yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Mariko Okawa. So yeah, so we have learned many things from this session, from the all the invited speakers, from the discussion. So as we know that we live in the maritime continent of Indonesia, which has strong interaction between land, coastal, ocean, and atmosphere. So what we did on the land may have an impact on the sea and the atmosphere, as well as when there is an anomaly in the sea, it can have an impact on the atmosphere and then have an impact on the land. So the bottom line is that we have a shared responsibility to maintain the health and sustainability of our environment for the sake of sustainability of natural resources for our future children and grandchildren. So I, Widodo Pranowo, as the moderator for this third plenary session, would like to express gratitude and appreciation to all the invited speakers and participants. Not forget also kindly great thanks to the INCREASE committee and also the Research Center for Climate and Atmosphere, Big Family, who did very a great job. Special thanks to Chief of the Committee, Dr. Wendy Harjupa. And also special thanks to Chief of the Editor, Dr. Abdul Basit, including special thanks for our timekeeper, Dr. Adis Purwaningsih. We wish God blessing us all. Thank you. Wassalamualaikum. Shalom. Om Santi. Santi Om. Keep stay healthy, safe, and sound. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Widodo, for hosting an insightful session. Now we've come to the end of our first day. Before we leave, I'd like to inform you that tomorrow we'll see each other again at 9 a.m. It's coming. The final slide here. Yes. The agenda for tomorrow is parallel sessions, and you can join by using the same Zoom link as we use today. The parallel session will be started in breakout rooms. And finally, before we actually leave, can we take a picture then? I kindly ask to switch on your videos and our team will take a picture of you. I really want to know your face, my lovely participants. So can you please switch on your video and our team will take our picture. Now, can see your face. Miss Nandini. How are you? Give me a big smile, please. Nice. We're still waiting for other participants to switch on your camera. Okay. Some people might be so shy, not showing up their face, but that's okay. Anytime the team ready taking a picture, just let me know so we can wrap up this session. Dr. Mariko, give me a big smile, please. Thank you. It's not finished yet. The picture is being taken. I can see your spirit from your face. It's a very lovely face. Okay, it's done. It's done. It's done. Thank you so much for your participation today. And see you. I just making like two sentences to close our session today. It's been a wonderful Tuesday with tons of knowledge necessary to know. It's been a great pleasure to have you today and see you tomorrow. You may leave.
See you. See you, Pak MC. Thank you very much.
Selamat ya, Ketua Panitia. Sukses berat.
Terima kasih Bu Prof, Kak Prof Widodo.
Tetap semangat.
Ya, makasih Bang Wendy, keren-keren.
Ya, sampai besok ya.
Yo.
Pak Prof, Assalamualaikum. Puji Tuhan. Terima kasih ya.